Hi, everybody. Welcome to Video Gold. Today we're going live in concert to learn a little bit about the history of our country in a very exciting way. We're also going on a witnessing visit to a haunted mansion. But first, I want to give testimony to what Jesus has done for me with a little help from the Spanish-speaking community. See if you can catch the Latino lingo during the raps as I perform a song from the Righteous Invasion of Truth record, simply called My Story.
Here we go, everybody. We're going to give glory to the Lord here today for what he has done in our lives. This is my story, giving all praises to the Lord. Are you ready? It goes like this. I say, glory to the Lord. Glory to his name. Here's my story.
About what the Lord has done for me. Antes era ciego, used to be blind, but now I see. And demons flee cuando I shout the name of Cristo. Don't need no gangs, no drugs, never get in the show. Don't need that pisto, cause Jesus Christ is the only thing that's running through my brain. The devil had me bound, but he broke them chains. Now to die is gain, and that's my story. Giving all praises to the El Shaddai. He saved my soul, so now I'm gonna praise him until the day is
done. Glory to the Lord. That's right, give glory to his name. Here's my story.
I think a testimony speaks of the touch point of what salvation has done in your life, how Jesus has changed your life. It's contrasted by what you were before, what you've become because of the grace and the love of Jesus Christ.
It's like groping in darkness and someone turned the lights on.
It's not just words. It's something they've experienced. It's something that they live out.
You know, there's something very powerful about a man's story. It's something you can't argue away because he's experienced it.
The other thing is, most people can really relate to a lot of testimonies that are told, depending on, I guess, their background also.
When I think about where I've been and where he's literally rescued me from, it causes each day to be filled with wonder and gratitude and worship.
It's just being a witness. It's like being on the witness stand, except that you are an audio-visual, Christian. You're not just talking about what's happened in your life, but there's a real demonstration in the way that you act and the lens that you look through, the way you treat people and the way you respond.
People are looking for hope. So a testimony, whether it be verbal or whether it be something that's lived out, I believe today has much better potential than it ever has.
The godly heritage of our country is something history cannot ignore. I was surprised to find out that of the first 125 colleges that were founded in the United States, almost all of them were headed up by pastors of churches. As a matter of fact, it used to be in our country that if you wanted to get a law degree, you must first have a degree in theology. The thought being, how can you enforce the laws of man if you don't first know the laws of God? When I brought these and other concepts to my concert audience, I had no idea how strongly these truths would resound in their spirits. America was founded on godly principles by men who prayed and sought their answers to governmental questions in the Bible. And it only stands to reason, if a country strays away from the Word of God, it strays away from the blessing of God. A few years ago, I wrote a song that I presented to the public on tour in 1994. When the people heard the truth about what made America great, they went crazy. From the album The Standard, the live in-concert version of America Again pretty much says it all.
You may be seated if you can. George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, Samuel Adams, first Chief Justice John Jay, names synonymous with the spirit of our country, founding fathers of the USA. Over 200 years ago, they shook off the chains of tyranny from Great Britain by divine call. Citing 27 biblical violations, they wrote the Declaration of Independence with liberty and justice for all. Well, something happened since Jefferson called the Bible the cornerstone for American liberty, that put it in our schools as a light. Or since Give Me Liberty or Give Me Death, Patrick Henry said, our country was founded on the gospel of Jesus Christ. We eliminated God from the equation of American life, thus eliminating the reason this nation first began. From beyond the grave, I hear the voices of our founding fathers plead. They're saying, you need God in America again. How many know what I'm talking about here tonight? You know what I'm talking about? Of the 55 men who formed the Constitution, 52 were active members of their church. Founding fathers like Noah Webster, who wrote the first dictionary, could literally quote the Bible, chapter and verse. James Madison said, we've staked our future and our ability to follow the Ten Commandments with all our heart. These men believed you couldn't even call yourself an American if you subvert the Word of God. In his farewell address, Washington said, you can't have national morality apart from religious principle. And it's true. Because right now we have nearly 150,000 kids carrying guns to these war zones we call public school. In the 40s and 50s, student problems were chewing gum and talking. In the 90s, rape and murder are the trend.
The only way this nation can even hope to last this decade is to put God in America again. The only hope for America is Jesus. The only hope for our country is Him. If we repent of our ways, stand firm and say we need God in America again. How many know what I'm talking about here tonight, you know? Abe Lincoln said the philosophy of the schoolroom in one generation will be the philosophy of government in the next. So when you eliminate the word of God from the classroom and politics, you eliminate the nation that word protects. America is now number one in teen pregnancy and violent crime, number one in literacy, drug use, and divorce. Every day a new Holocaust of 5,000 unborn die, while pornography floods our streets like open sewers. America's dead and dying hand is on the threshold of the church, while the spirit of Sodom and Gomorrah vex us all. Now when it gets to the point where people would rather come out of the closet than clean it, it's the sign the judgment of God is gonna fall. If there's ever been a time to rise up, church, it's now. And as the blood-bought saints of the living God proclaim, that it's time to sound the alarm from the church house to the White House and say, we want God in America again! I believe it's time, America, to stand up and proclaim that one nation under God is our demand. And send this evil lifestyle back to Satan where it came from. Let the word of God revive our dying land. For Jesus Christ is coming back again in all his glory, and every eye shall see him on that day. That's why a new anointing of God's power is coming on us to boldly tell the world you must be saved. Because astrology won't save you. Your horoscope won't save you. The Bible says these things are all a farce. If you're born again, you don't need to look to the stars for your answers. You can look to the very one who made those stars. History tells us time and time again, to live like there's no God makes you a fool. Look, if you want to see kids live right, stop handing out condoms. Start handing out the word of God in school. Somebody say the only hope for our country is Him. If we repent of our ways, stand firm and say we need God in America again. Can you say the only hope for America? For our country is, if we repent of our, stand firm and say, we need God in America again. We need God in America. Do you know we need God in America? Somebody say, we need God in America.
America was founded on the gospel of Jesus Christ, and the people that founded it, that's what they wrote inside the Constitution. They wrote, in God we trust, even in the Pledge of Allegiance. It's in God.
In God we trust means that God is providing and taking care of this nation. You know what I mean? The prosperity of this nation is because it was founded upon godly principles.
You can just look at the news and all you see are violence, from rapes to murders.
But it can't be like that. If we want an awesome country, there's guidelines that we have to follow. Otherwise, our country's not gonna have any integrity at all. It's gonna go down the drain.
As a lawyer today, as I'm practicing law, I see we have agnostic courts that are entirely separated now from God. And it's wrong. It's not what our founding fathers intended.
And what people so often misinterpret is what Jefferson said, you know, that he wasn't trying to keep church out of the government. He wasn't trying to keep religion out of the government. He's trying to keep the government out of religion.
We need Christians to make that intended pursuit to get into government and areas where it's going to change and affect our law.
All you can do is just take a look around you and you can just tell that God needs to be back in America again.
I'll remember the day as long as I live. I had flown into my hometown of Tulsa, Oklahoma from the Radically Saved tour back in 1989. I was very tired and really needed to be in my home church Sunday night hearing my pastor preach one of his anointed sermons. Some of you know what I'm talking about. When I got there, I was told that the service was moved from the church to a 4,000 seat chapel on the ORU campus. They were having a special speaker and they needed the extra seats to accommodate the crowd. I was so disappointed. I had flown in just to hear my pastor and to be in my church, and there's some new guy who I'd never heard before showing up to preach. Well, the speaker was a guy named Mario Murillo. And when he started to speak, I was completely blown away. His oratory was magnificent, passionate, and intelligent. He told a story that night about a request he'd gotten in the mail from a warlock who wanted to discuss spiritual matters. By the time he was done, I was standing and shouting, and I knew at that moment I had to write a song about this encounter. So, what you are about to see is a true story. It actually happened, just like the song says. One interesting note. The guy who played my antagonist in the video was not an on-fire-for-the-Lord professing Christian, but did at the time tell me years ago he sung in a gospel group and the Lord had been trying to get to him for years. Once he finished the video, God had done an incredible work in his life and his perspective had changed dramatically. When you see the video, A Witch's Invitation, you'll understand why.
Peaceful afternoon, I picked up from my mailbox the strangest looking letter I'd ever seen. A chilling little envelope bordered with flying bats and eerie serpents whose eyes were tinted green. Now, the letter was addressed to me, so as I opened it, I froze. What I read turned my complexion three shades of blue. It said, "My name is Isaac Horowitz. I'm a male witch, a warlock. I feel I need to spend some time with you." Now, as a Christian from a little church with God's call on my life, a man of faith and power with a challenge to grow, I did what any saint would do in my situation. I tore it up, said, "Lord, no way, I'm gonna go." And gently and methodically, the Holy Spirit spoke and reminded me, we're God's voice to our nation. It's the church's responsibility to witness. So reluctantly, I accepted this witch's invitation. He had the house you'd expect, the old English cottage, a Nightmare on Elm Street special right to the core, the overgrown ivy, the gate that creaked when opened. Somehow you'd expect Freddy to answer this door. The doorbell rang, a hollow gong. The knob twisted, then opened. And Isaac stood before me with a grin. His jet black hair and well-trimmed beard flowed with his black silk clothes. My skin crawled as he said, "Please, come on in." His house was filled with every occultic symbol you can fathom. Hanging pentagrams and horoscope signs. A Ouija board and Dungeons and Dragons game set on the table. A crystal ball with an
incandescent shine, and graciously he handed me some steaming herbal tea. Its presence caused my memory to jog. I thought of every horror flick I'd seen when I was a kid, and thought, man, you drink this stuff next day, you'll be a frog. And he led me to a high back chair as he meticulously began to unfold his scenario with evil patience. I was given a giant leather-bound book jammed with newspaper clippings, thus the reason for this witch's invitation. With eagerness, he pointed to each article with pride. He said, I healed this woman through a Babylonian chant. You see, this man, I cured him while performing druid worship. I was paid to curse this man with AIDS by his aunt. On and on, page after page, delightfully he flaunted each incident for an hour without a breath. He said, do you realize through my understanding of the dark regions that I can make you rich or even curse someone to death? I sat literally intimidated by his immensity and demon power, while his face shone with a satanic arrogant bliss. Then placing his hands on the arms of my chair and leaning into my face, he said, what can your God do to compete with this? I knew then how Moses felt when his rod turned to a serpent and the three Egyptian magicians did the same. It's as if you're sitting there in that stunned moment where your faith gets violated and all you feel is weak, powerless, and lame. I desperately and deeply prayed, saying, Jesus, give me wisdom. I don't want to put you through some foolish test. Then a shaft of light shot through my soul, igniting my eyes with fire. God stood me up, and I threw the book back in his chest. I said, Isaac, I'll not compare God's miracles versus Satan's. The issue's not God's kingdom and Satan's lair. The real comparison is the condition of your soul and the condition of mine, and you puppet of the devil, that I will compare. I said, my friend, one day they're coming for you. The soft associates in your incantations, the friendly demons you think you now control. The time will come when you'll be lying in bed, wheezing like a dying animal, when those spirits lay claim to the rights they own to your soul. Then the room will grow dark, and the most hideous evil faces you've ever seen will come flaming out of the floor with a yell. The vile informants that promised reincarnation will claw your spirit and victoriously drag your soul to hell. Then I grabbed the book and says, in that moment, which mantra, which incantation are you gonna chant to tell them to leave you alone? I said, my friend, I know beyond a shadow of a doubt what I would say. I am bought with the blood of Jesus. Let me go. I said, Isaac, when you tossed that book in my lap, you gloated with a sinister victory. You rejoiced when you saw your name in black and white. Now I rejoice, but not that your council of demons are subject to Jesus, but that my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Then Isaac jumped up from his chair and screamed, you must leave now! I says, I will, but one last obligation. Next time, think twice before you rumble with a man of God. And by the way, thanks for your witch's invitation.
We need to be aware that witchcraft is real and that there are people that do submit themselves to that power.
When people just let that happen, I mean, pretty soon they feel powerless and they feel like God is powerless.
Someone that approaches you in the occult, their necessary thing is they're wanting a demonstration of power, like Elijah on the mountain of Carmel, calling down fire from heaven. Whose God will you serve?
Satan can challenge the power of God, and he has done that since the beginning.
But he cannot overpower the kingdom of God or any of God's
power.
When we as Christians rise up and use the power and the authority that God has invested in us, and I don't care if you're a janitor, you're a housewife, or whoever you are, the name of Jesus works for everyone who will take him into your heart and use that name. It will work, and it will push back the forces of darkness.
Sometimes when we're faced with a person who is either involved in the occult or witchcraft, or something else, how would Jesus respond to that person?
They have a void in their heart for someone to love them, someone to care for them, someone to show them that there is a purpose and a plan.
But Jesus said, what does it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his soul? I want my eternal security.